Welcome. It's a great honor to introduce you to the fellows today and to give you a chance to meet this impressive first class. They're trying to solve a really big problem. We live in the internet age, which is transforming every aspect of society. And yet, many of the people who write and enforce policy still don't understand technology. Presidential candidates talk about shutting down parts of the internet because they're inconvenient. Even Elena Kagan says there are some Supreme Court justices that still haven't quite figured out email. Oh, and by the way, I have to do that. There are some people at Ford that haven't quite figured out PowerPoint. This is a serious problem, and it's only going to get worse as technology becomes more enmeshed with all of our lives. Usually when I present the internet freedom work, I get to talk about the dangers of surveillance or exciting wins by our grantees on net neutrality, on prison phone justice. But today, we're doing something different. We're going to take you behind the scenes to look at the beta version of this fellows program. And you're going to learn lessons from this first year where we've placed technologists into NGOs and civil society organizations, both to advance the public internet and the open internet, but also to figure out how do you actually add a tech lens to social justice work. And before I pass the mic to our partners and one of the host organizations and the fellows, I want to talk a little bit about our original inspiration for doing a fellows program like this. And I want to start with the color blue. So how many of you guys listen to podcasts or listen to like Radiolab? Okay, good. So there was a great radio lab called Colors that was on recently, and the episode cited research that said that many ancient languages didn't actually have a word for blue. So not Greek, not Chinese, not Japanese, not Hebrew. And without that word for the color in ancient texts, there's real evidence that people may have never actually seen blue, which is strange, because there's so much blue on the earth. The water is blue. The sky is blue. Were the ancient people that lived on the earth colorblind? Did our eyes physically evolve so in later generations we actually could see blue? Was it maybe a conceptual innovation where we actually separated blue from green in some crazy way? Technology is also everywhere. It's around us everywhere, and yet for so much of the world, it's still invisible. Maybe not completely invisible, but maybe invisible in significant ways. Where for many of us, there's just not the words yet to describe or see the transformation we're currently living through. So I want to give you an example of what I'm talking about. When I first came to Ford, 2008, as a program officer, I made a grant to Wikipedia. And one of my colleagues said to me, I looked at Wikipedia once. There was an error on the page. And she wasn't wrong. I think the error was like the name of one of the Ford Foundation presidents or something. It was like not a little error. And yet, I'd still argue that this colleague of mine, though she was super smart, was colorblind around technology. You know, she looked at Wikipedia like it was a book, like it could be measured like a book could be measured. And she couldn't see beyond a book-bound encyclopedia and what that offered. So really, I thought the only thing you're taking away from the largest egalitarian, collaboratively produced accumulation of knowledge that ever existed in the world in hundreds and hundreds of languages is that there's one error in it. And like what, you know? I mean, if you look at Encyclopedia Britannica, I mean, all of these physical encyclopedias are literally riddled with errors the minute they're put on a shelf. If you take a quick look at the last edition of Encyclopedia Britannica, for example, Prince is working on a new record, and this guy over here is thinking about starting a television show. Technologists are doing this work, and they regularly face the frustration. The frustrating question of, how do I translate what I see? How do I help others put on this tech lens? And visionaries like the fellows that you meet today have seen the blue of technology for years and years. From the first meeting I actually even held with the internet rights grantees, they were like, please, please, can you bring us some public interest technologists? But back then, the financial resources in this field were so small that if we were to use our budget on building one of these fellows programs from the ground up, it would have been the entire budget. So we did what we could. We funded some technologists. We tried to study and we tried to document the need. And here you can see Darren with one of the studies we did, which is called the Ford and MacArthur Foundation's funded Future of Failure, very optimistic. And it basically showed all the ways that the market was not going to solve the problem of bringing technologists into NGOs, into government, and frankly, into philanthropy. We did another report called A Pivotal Moment, which went deeper and tried to be more optimistic. It proposed solutions. And we learned that there were few systems to recruit, train, place, retain, partner with, bring these technologists where we needed them to go. And more frightening, there really wasn't any urgency to do so. But the strangest finding we found was the fact that most technologists couldn't even imagine a career for themselves in advocacy and policy. There were few, and the few that were actually excited about this, most of them didn't have the skills to make them effective advocates in a policy environment. So it seemed like a new problem until we looked at it more closely. And when we looked at it more closely, we realized it's kind of old. You know, we've actually done this before. If you just exchange the word law for the word technology, we actually had a model we could work with. And we looked at the historic investments that the foundation had made in public interest law. Because if you think about it, you know, back in the 60s, lawyers were white. Lawyers worked for rich people. Access to legal support for poor and working people was out of the reach of many. And there was a little legal infrastructure in place to use the law to push for social good. So in 1972, some people will recognize the very young woman on this slide, but in 1972, the Ford Foundation gave $500,000, which was an astounding amount of money at the time. And this went to support a survey and essays that were in effect the beginning of what became known as the field of public interest law. The work became the blueprint to reimagine the social justice role of lawyers and devise strategies to sustain public interest law till it could be made financially sustainable in the market. And within a decade, lawyers created more than 90 public interest law firms. We piloted projects that would support public defenders, law clinics, pro bono legal systems, and more importantly, we invested in people, in lawyers, through public interest law fellowships themselves. These investments had a powerful impact. You could argue there would be no Civil Rights Act, no Americans with Disabilities Act, there'd be no sexual harassment protections, and we'd have no gay marriage laws if it weren't for public interest law. So we have to learn from the achievements in public interest law and begin to use them as inspiration for establishing public interest wins in technology. This room contains a new generation of visionary thinkers. People bold enough to confront and change the Luddite landscape and to do the incredibly difficult and sometimes boring and sometimes emotionally draining work of collaborating with and learning from different types of people and supporting existing fields to transform them. Where others see a challenge, you see potential. Where others feel scared and geeked out, overwhelmed, you feel confident, you feel curious, you feel hopeful, you roll up your sleeves and you open your laptops. More and more people are finally seeing this challenge. We've got some other funders in the field who've been working with us to think about all the other structures that need to be in place. And, you know, clearly the fellows are only one step on the journey, but the first step is a pretty important step when you're starting a new journey. So 40 years from now, I hope that someone in Ford is standing in this room and telling you the story about how all of you transformed, how the world thinks about technology and social justice, and how you all transformed the history of how civil society embraces technology.